Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Dota 2 Championship League live stream. I'm going to say welcome back because it has been a while since I've actually been on this live stream. Traveling down to Korea, casting up some really awesome games down there, but now I'm back here in my studio in Berlin to stream out the match for you to this evening. In fact, we've got two matches coming to you tonight. We're going to be starting off with, Team Liquid going up against Fnatic, and the following game will be Alliance going up against Sigma. Now, both these games are normally meant to be best of threes for both Alliance and Sigma because it is a deciding matchup depending who goes into the semifinals and who goes into the quarterfinals. Both teams decided with a great time limit as well, which is imposed on them with a whole bunch of different tournaments. They'll be playing their game as a best of one tonight. So we have a best of three and a best of one coming for you tonight. Of course, we do have our teams coming up on the board. My American co-caster, who's not actually that American, we found out early before, Clairvoyance Man, welcome to your broadcast.
All right, man, Toby, it's always good to be here. Always good to be able to watch some of the best Dota available in the Western scene and see the development of these teams and see how they fall just before some of the biggest events coming up for you this year, post TI3 into TI4. And you know, when you think of Tier 1 names, we see something like Team Liquid, which has been on a complete domination path, just destroying everybody in their way, maybe barring Na'Vi and Alliance. Those are the two teams that they always say they have struggles with. But everybody else, I think their latest record is something like 16-0. And they've just been crushing everyone that's been standing in their path. As for Fnatic, something of a similar story, I would like to say. Having a little bit of trouble with Na'Vi and Alliance, as with every other team. But even Na'Vi and Alliance have trouble with Na'Vi and Alliance. But basically, yeah, they've been on a roll pretty much, taking out a lot of wins. I think they've been facing EG up a lot lately. And they've been doing pretty decent on that front. Beating Speed, I think, the other day, as well as a couple other teams here and there. But very interesting set of bans coming out, too, because with the new patch, I'm not sure if you got a chance to play the new heroes, but all I got to say is you toss those spirits into this metagame before MLG Columbus, and if that happens, disaster will ensue.
I'm pretty sure they won't get themselves in. Like, yeah, all new heroes, they have to go through the test of the pubs before we find out if they are balanced or not. Also, speaking of balance, sorry guys, I realized the music was a little bit too loud before while we're chatting. As I said before, I'm keeping my eyes peeled for all the possible technical issues which could be arising because some wonderful people have fiddled with my settings. So not everything is as balanced as it normally was before.
Ah, fiddlesticks. That's a nice League of Legends
There was a great movie, and there was someone that said a line, I just don't like people touching my things! I don't know what it is.
But it has a very Forrest Gumpy vibe to it.
No, it's definitely not Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump would never get angry like that. He'd never get angry. Right, right. He's like, my things. People be touching my things.
Wow. Well, I'm not sure if that can be invoked. Alright, I tried that. Never mind, I'm not even going to go with you.
Attempted
pun. All I can say is, Invoker's the next draft, Toby. And I got to say, that's a hero that Hani's been playing rather often lately. Mm-hmm. To moderate success, I'd like to say. Something like pretty much goes even in the mid-game, or pardon me, not the mid-game. Pretty much goes even in the mid lane rather often, and then proceeds to get a lot of farm and a lot of nice items with the Blink Dagger and the Seldom Force Staff, as well as the Aghanim Scepter and all the other things that he needs. And yeah, starts to dish out a lot of spells, a lot of magical burst damage coming out, as well as disables, lockdown. This hero has 10 spells available in his arsenal, so a lot of different possibilities and combinations. But what really ticks me is that Liquid are giving a lot of respect to Fnatic Wisp, and it's something that's always been talked of. No-Tails Wisp is definitely up there as the best, if not one of the best. And a hero that's kind of fallen out, but still getting mentioned. It means that things have been in the woodworks with these players going against each other in scrims and giving respect to each other and saying, you know, I've seen you draft that hero not just once or twice. I've seen you play it effectively against us with specific strategies. I'm going to rule it out and give ourselves the best chance. And Liquid, picking up the Nature's Prophet as the first pick, and Fnatic with that bold second pick in Volker. I must say, I'm a little bit surprised that there has been no mention of Clockwork, Bounty Hunter, or Timbersaw in the first drafting stage.
10 seconds. It's like they almost completely ignored their offlane until this point. It's kind of funny considering the last game that I cast, which was the DK versus Alliance game, and most of the time they just focused on banning up against that offlaner. It's the hardest lane to control in the current patch. Like, what are you really supposed to do up against, like, these Clockworks and Timbersaw or off lanes kind of thing? Yeah, it's It's a rough life. It's a rough life. That's actually kind of what I like Fnatic with their pickup of Invoker. It's this hero which, like, most people got used to playing up against him a couple of months ago. And now, not many people play up against Invoker. Not many people still play the Invoker on a solo mid. And can you really say there is a straight-up direct counter to the Invoker in the middle lane at any time?
I guess it's kind of a hard one. But I do think that there are some heroes that do exceptionally well against a hero in general. I know for one that, pardon me, I know for one that if Liquid see Invoker being picked up by Fnatic, they have never hesitated to take either the Elder Titan, which is banned, of course, or the Beastmaster as the second option. And you know what? Looking at Liquid's draft right now, the Bats and the Nature's Prophet with the split push and Beastmaster's range of initiation, that's looking to be a really, really good hero. So I'm not too sure if Liquid's going to pass up on the Beastmaster. I really do feel like they're going to take it, especially with the Weaver and the Fray now. You want that extra bit of lockdown that you can get before the Lincolns, and even after the Lincolns, it still helps. So, yeah, I'm feeling a Beastmaster pick coming out relatively soon. I would say not saved up to the last pick, but maybe the fourth pick.
Is Tuka with Beastmaster?
Yeah, I do. I do smell Beastmaster. I think they've just been playing it against Honey's Invoker every single time. And, you know, every time I talk to
them. I'll be waiting for the Pugner and the Chen really coming out from Liquid. I look at you're right. You're 100% right. I should never doubt my co-casters ever.
No. I like the idea that you had, because obviously with the Chen, and it actually completely passed me, is that with the Chen, you could have done a lot of early game pushing. And Invoker, one of the reasons he actually fell off before all the nerfs hit him really, really hard, is that he was very, very susceptible to pushes. Not just ganks. Invoker is a pretty tough cookie to take down, you know, with the X Sword and the Quas giving you intelligence and base strength. It makes you a little bit tanky, gives you that extra regen, but definitely it's very susceptible to pushing. And Nature's Prophet and Beastmaster is just another form of that pushing, just comes in a later stage.
Yeah. It's still possible we see portions of it. Like, you can run Pugner on the safe lane, so you can still do it, and then have your inner beast aura to help out with all of that. But I was also thinking on like the double effect. Like, you got the Invoker, as you're talking about, like, you can push up against him, but then you get Weaver, a guy who needs time to find farm. Now you also get a Mirana into the pool for Fnatic, and unless that's a support Mirana and it becomes a carry Mirana, you need space for that Mirana to get farm to do some decent damage, because you can find yourself sitting there with the Maelstrom and you've lost all your outer towers, and you're like, well, what kind of damage can I dish to push everybody back out of the lanes? Give us some space to farm. It just doesn't exist anymore. So that's the main reason why I was thinking the Pugner. It was also because my brain and my meta is still tainted by the weekend and the 14-minute push which came out from DK.
Yeah. Pugna definitely be really strong in that. You know, I thought as soon as I saw Pugna being picked up religiously ever since the beginning of this new patch, I was thinking to myself, wow, this hero either looks silly stupid or ridiculously broken. And by silly stupid, I mean, like, yeah, it's broken in a sense, but kind of a weird way. It's like if you build the Necrobook really fast, you're just going to take out towers and stuff. But it's a very, and I know this word is just overused these days, but it's a very niche pick. Like, it's a pick that you pick it first, and pretty much the rest of the draft is very, very obvious what you're going to aim for, because you're not going to pick a Pugna and then try to pick a hard carry on the safe lane and get a greedy off lane or like that, because maybe trying to mix in a little bit of push and a little bit of farm. It just doesn't come, because Pugna just offers you so much on that offensive front that you want to just go over the top with it. So most of the time you just end up seeing all these all-in pushes kind of thing where the Pugna kind of loses past 30, 40, although Pugna can transition pretty nicely with items. And lately all I've seen is if I don't see the Pugna being mentioned in the first four picks, and by then there's already four bans as well, then it's probably going to get omitted. So Liquid's going for the Rubick now. I guess it's preventing the Beastmaster steal, but also it gives a lot of different potential abilities that the Rubick can take, namely the Scoochie coming out of the Weaver. It's always a fantastic ability for Rubick's initiation. And the Luna getting banned out by Fnatic, so they are absolutely aware of what Liquid's lineup can potentially bring to them. So I think that Luna ban is a fantastic call. And I'm just curious to see what Liquid's last pickup is going to be.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it too, Matt. Can you keep going for a moment? I just realized something else in the big point battle is not going 100% right. So I'm having to modify some stuff for that one.
I see. Well, Fnatic is going to be picking up their last hero in a few moments, because they don't have too much time on their draft left. They have about 10 seconds on the previous as well as 11 on the reserve time. And right now, I feel like they have a lot of magical sources and good escape and survivability. There's a lot of well-rounded stuff, but what I really feel like is they need a tank initiation bruiser type of hero, something that can just go in, start the fight. This Invoker, Weaver, Mirana lineup is very reminiscent of a Tidehunter, but Axe is going to be their choice for the initiation. The brute force that is tanking up everything at the front lines is going to be the Axe, and I'm not too sure how well Axe will do against the majority of Liquid's lineup, which is pretty int heavy based, range int heavy based. And of course, Battle Hunger is known to reap through that very nicely, along with the Berserker's Call. If he can get it off, is the problem though. So if the Axe is going for an early Blink Dagger, this game might change its pace very, very quickly. But if the Axe cannot get into the range of initiation, at best he's good for soaking up damage, and frankly, Axe is not exactly the best at that without tanky items. So sure. Axe has always been a toss-up that way.
See, I'm looking at it from this perspective of just like pure laning, and I know too from also the previous perspective that no Axes these days are even going anywhere near Berserker's Call until like level 8 or 9. Then they start to touch on that. So I'm thinking early game laning, they want to try and pin the Axe up against Nature's Prophet. That way, at least, there's no harassment damage Prophet could do directly towards Axe, because tree damage is okay, but the chance of a spin is probably going to be better for you as an Axe. But that means you've got to throw an extra supporter up there just to make sure he's okay. So if they run something like a CM Axe, and then put Mirana on the bottom lane, pulling to help out the Weaver on the bottom lane, or switch the supports around and then invoke for the solo mid, I'm really interested to see how Fnatic want to try and find their synergy, and how strong that's going to be in their lanes too, because a CM and an Axe is like, well, that's okay, but both of them have escape mechanisms up against a Rubick who's got telekinesis control, Visage, you've got Grave Chill control, and then you've got Bulb who can rotate in with level 6 as well, so that's going to cause more issues later on. And on top of that, now we add a Gyro to the mix who, if we want to say there's a homing missile up his sleeve, we've got a TP in from Coit for his Nature's Prophet into a Sprout, all these different things which Liquid have. The control is just so much better for them, as well as what it seems to be, the lanes seem to be a lot better for them as well.
Yeah, and my mind is on the lanes as well. I mean, lately, all the acts that we've seen, or from what I've seen anyway, has something to do with creep skipping and trying to get that early advantage by trying to abuse the hero the best way you can. Of course, he's a strength hero, a lot of good HP value. His armor is not the best, but most of the time that's going to be mitigated, or that's going to be consolidated by the stealth shield that he picks up. And with the clarity in his inventory, I do feel like, yeah, Trixie's Axe is going to look to be very, very aggressive from early on. So I'm curious to see how this will pan out. But I do slightly fear that this hero, known for his ability to snowball, no matter how many heroes you can dunk, it doesn't necessarily contribute towards pushing towers. And of course, I know Fnatic that they have a lot of damage, a fair bit of damage coming out from Hani with the X-Sword as well as a couple other heroes. But let's see if it can successfully turn the tides of multiple team fights and transition to something from a snowball into an avalanche. Because right now, I got to be a Debbie Downer here and say I'm doubting this Axe pick. I'm not sure if it's going to be very successful, but here comes the rotation, Toby, from Fnatic. The Fnatic train with the Axe going towards mid lane and top lane.
Yeah, so they're gonna try and do this with an aggressive tri lane. Leave Ira by himself up against, at this point, it's way too sexy, but it should be Coitfa at the end of the day. Yeah, he's going to summon new sentries and head down south. So they could be, no, in fact, they're going to leave Sentry Wars down here. So Liquid's already cottoned on to the fact of what's going on. Way too early to leave the Sentry Wars at the bottom so they can watch Era's Weaver, who gets possibly the most redundant rune he could ever get, which is going to be the Invis rune. Middle lane will then fly on the Crystal Maiden. Hani is the Invoker, so they're going to start this with a Jewel lane, or at least Jewel to block it up. Bulbut will be the Beastmaster here in the middle lane. It puts way too sexy on a rotation up with a Visage towards the top lane to join his other support player, Fluff and Stuff, as the Rubick for Team Liquid, and they're babysitting TC, who's farming up as the Gyro. And then we get our off lane, which is, it's going to be Axe and the Mirana. So the support heroes did switch up from what I was thinking they might do, but it's still Trixie on the front lines. Tango's Salve, Stout Shield, and let's see how much he can tank, and let's see how long he can survive, because already Fluff and Stuff's going to force him out. And Quaver on this bottom lane, too. I'm interested to see how well he's going to go down here. Like, you got Sentry Wars down there, so you at least got yourself some vision and some extended vision time over on Era. But how well is Era going to be able to tank up against that harassment from Nature's Prophet, especially when the trees start doing this? They get taken off and pushing directly and attacking on the Weaver directly.
Yeah, part of my pause for there for a moment. I had a slight cough there for a second, but yeah, with the Sentry Wards, this Prophet versus Weaver has always been a critical matchup. So I'm surprised how Era's going to do up as well, because with the Sentry Wards, all of a sudden becomes that much more difficult. And when Sprout is online, or when three treants are coming out of Nature's Call, we can already see that Quaver's getting so much more out of this lane, because the lane's already pushed up from the start. giving him a lot more room for maneuverability to just walk around the map and abuse his superior range against a hero like Weaver. So Koipa doing a really, really good job right now, and all of a sudden I'm beginning to understand why the early Prophet pick came up, Alliance style kind of play.
It's just a hero, man, that you can't turn down. You can't turn down Nature's Prophet at any point. What he brings to the game, and the ability to also have like a plan B with Prophet, and while he's still a very strong plan A, you just can't pass that kind of stuff up. Mm-hmm. I don't see how teams can pass it up.
Yeah, man, just the fact that you have the summons, the global TP, and massive burst nuke ultimate that can kind of be used for farming as well. There's just so many purposes that this hero can provide. And Battle Hunger coming out for the first time at the top lane, I believe. Way Too Sexy's the one that's getting caught of the fire. But let's see if TC can give his support a kill here. And looks like he's just going to tank up the damage.
Unfortunately, like even with the Battle Hunger up, like this one, I'm not really getting the synergy of this top lane. Like, Battle Hunger, that's great. You're going to get some extra movement speed for Trixie. Gets in, gets out. I suppose that's a nice little part of that one. And hey! You didn't see that one either! Cold snap?
No, I completely missed that one. I'm actually surprised that came down. I mean, it was a rotation from the CM, that's understandable.
Oh, top lane. This is what we were waiting for. Trixie to get into Telekinesis, Rocket Barrage back up again, Fade Bolt and Soul Assumption damage. That's what we were both waiting for that top lane.
Yeah, and I know what you were getting at. Like, the lack of commitment in this lane, I mean, it's fine for an Axe to just dish out a spell and drop harassment damage, but what's the point of harassment damage if the enemy team knows that you can actually not touch them at all? Like, we know with the gyrocopter in the lane, this Axe is getting nowhere near the supports. You're not going to tank Rocket Barrage level 2 damage and survive that outcome. There is no way. Okay. So this Battle Hunger at best is doing just a little bit of tickling here and there, and not much else of anything else.
I could be really depressed now. I got to restart my counter. 2.5 weeks without missing a first blood, even through the entire Dota 2 Invitational when I was there casting on the main stage of G-Star. Still didn't miss the first blood. I come back to Berlin. It's good to see. We're back to our roots, people. We're back to our roots.
I'm telling you, man. It's the co-cast factor. Just told me I'm too strong, man. What can I say?
I thought the co-cast factor is the co-caster meant to look out for you.
What? When?
So the co-caster's like, yo, man, middle lane, they're going to get themselves a kill.
No, of course not, Toby. I knew it was happening, but I did not want to interrupt you. You know what I'm saying?
I said to high level bullshit. Koipa getting pushed off this bottom lane. He's got phase boost now up and running, so this bottom lane completely changes around now. With the phase boost up on Koipa, we see it time and time again from this guy. The second he can go full on aggressive on his off lane, he'll do it. While I'm also keeping an eye on that middle lane again. So Flyers coming in with smoke and Bulba. They want him to walk down a little bit further, and now they can do this. So this will be Frostbite. They're going to go for the Cold Snap, and then following it up with the Cold Snap, in with the extra damage. There's no Forge Spirits this time around, so Bulb was able to escape Harney. Possibility to invoke a Sunstriper. It's only at level 2, so it wouldn't be enough to pick up Bulba. And Bulba pops the Regeneration Rune. So gank, unsuccessful.
Yeah, I think there were an ample number of things that Fnatic could have done better there. For one, you could have probably waited out the Nova duration a little bit more, or talked about when the Frostbite was really going to happen. Because Hani had the Forge Spirits up coming up near the end there, and he did not cast it. And also, his Cold Snap, if you noticed, like, the intervals didn't really hit at very critical moments. Like, the thing with Cold Snap is you have to actually cast it when one of your attack animations is in the air, so it'll trigger the next stun instance immediately. And what ended up happening was, after the Cold Snap, there was no attack animations in the air, so instead of a potential 3-4 stuns coming out, the Cold Snap only did work for about 2 stuns.
Trixie, you're so totally toast on the top lane, man. Like, then again, he's doing a lot of damage to TC, needed a couple more spins then, but gets held up in Koipa's Sprout, and Way Too Sexy just comes in with the last bit of Soul Assumption damage, and TC, he'll survive that Battle Hunger as well. Guys, apologies, live stream dropped, I don't know what was going on, seems the server we were connected into wasn't too great. And we ended up losing some frames and dropped. But now, changed it up, so we're all good to go. Everything seems to be stable again.
Things are A-okay, Toby. Once again, back from Korea. Back to business.
Back to business. Back to my wonderful studio and how everything's meant to work.
Yeah, come on, Toby. Holidays are over. Please, you do not get to sleep at 8 in the evening anymore.
Well, actually, I always did tonight. Oh, way too. No, there's enough. There's just no damage from this Murano. If this was like a normal 6-minute Murano, leap in.
I don't know about that leap.
It may be enough damage. Trixie's coming in really, really deep. They got enough to kill the Gyro, but now Bulba's rotation up. Trissy gets hit by Prophet Altman as well, who seems to have picked up the Weaver on the bottom lane. And now into Battle Hunger, but he's going to get roared up. There's not enough spins to save him from this. So three heroes for the price of one. The Gyro on the top lane. When Weaver goes down, diving underneath the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane, it looks to be.
Oh my. That Weaver death is going to cost them big. Because Era still had time lapse in that situation. And of course, he didn't get to use it, obviously. But giving that solo kill to Koipa, that is going to cost him. I'm not too sure if he can come back from this lane anymore. If Koipa decides to not stay in the jungle, or he's farming up the jungle to get an extra bit of gold, which is understandable because he's so close to his Midas. But if he just stays in the lane and zones out Era further, Era's going to have a really, really hard time recovering, because we know that Weaver, single target hero with not many abilities to flash farm, doesn't catch up all that well as he snowballs.
I'm just making a note on my side for the drop time so we can fix the problem next time.
Note to self, Weaver does not come back. Snowballs well.
All right. I wasn't making a note for that one, but even though that's a good thing to make a note about, no, it's the server drop time. Fly, you're in a lot of trouble. Crystal Maiden, Frostbite is possible, but then again, if you can't see anything, you can't really do much about it. So a quick Nova, and the Koifa will get the kill over to Crystal Maiden. It was just rotating into the jungle and found too many heroes, both Fluff and Koifa hanging around.
Yep, and in the meanwhile, a nice slam down coming out of Trixie, a very simple gank executed, just a nice arrow being landed by No-Tail, followed up by the Axe, just chasing down the target, and once the Battle Hunger and the right-click did enough damage, boom, right into the sinker, the Axe of Justice.
Heroes gonna try and commit to Fluff and stuff. Shakuching up, there's no sentry ward this high up, but the second he saw TC, he backed up. But Fluff and stuff gets his pick up and a throw back on Era, but he's still got time-lapse available. He just didn't want to take that risk coming in too close on a Jar and getting telekinesis into that kind of burst damage. Top lane, we're going again. Yeah, familiar stun, so it's going to make it impossible for him to keep up. Nice arrow from No-Tail. It's a good 5-second stun, but with that Prophet ultimate damage again coming in to combine it with the Visage damage, there's just not enough stability on that top lane.
Mm-hmm. I wish I saw...
Fly, dead. Call down, telekinesis dragged and smack bang into the middle of it, and the second rocket takes him out like a nuke.
Yeah, so pardon me if I'm wrong, but I really wish I saw bit more attempts on Sunstrike coming out of Hani this game. He's been playing rather stale at the mid lane. Of course, the mid lane being the two position that's played as one these days, it's understandable that if you pick up the Midas, you kind of want to farm, but his battle involvement and just involvement in general, I feel like it could be better with a little bit more awareness of the surroundings. Like, a lot of targets, like, for example, even the 5-second arrow at top, that could have done a lot of work with the Sunstrike if it hit the Visage. What it would have done is put Visage in the threshold for Culling Blade and allow Trixie to follow it up. And unfortunately, Trixie is now going to get followed up on.
Yep, there's your roar off the initiation from the Sprout and Fluff and stuff. If he wants to telekinesis, he can, but he's going to Fade Bolt to kill Secure. That's a good thing he did too, because that allows him to have enough money to finish up the Arcane Boost. So he helps everybody by doing so.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like Hani is putting a lot of focus into the mid lane when his team needs some global backup right now. And he has the potential to do so.
But you can't really blame him for not trying to go for these kills. Like, Fluff and Stuff's an option for him. Middle lane, way too sexy. Like, he'll get picked off here in the middle lane. The way to also purposefully put some extra points up in that Gravekeeper's Cloak at the very early levels. So he knows it's a very, very tanky hero to try and bring down anyway.
Yeah, of course, the recent patch did nerf him, so he kind of needs the Gravekeepers to keep up in the early levels. And then, of course, later on, he gets extremely tanky.
Oh, nice arrow. 5 seconds on the Bulba. Sunstrike, there's what you're asking for, coming down. Even gets its Nile on the tower, and Culling Blade is now possible. No, it's too early! Just a second too early! He's still got the spin-off, Fade Bolt Fly. He's in a little bit more trouble. Fluff and stuff, he had Weaver's Bugs being used, and Prophet's Ultimate bounces through and takes out the Mirana on the way through. Prophet now going to TP himself in here, decides to cancel it because he saw Hani coming up the ramp, but Trixie is still very, very low on life. But with Hani around there, he can't really commit to that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a wise idea. Of course, a cold snap is pretty much the bane of many, many NTO's existences, and Prophet does crumble to the right clicks of an invoker with a cold snap. So, wise decision and good awareness out of him to see that and not commit to an axe kill, which would have been worth it if he got out scot free, but probably doubtful that he would have done so. And nice Sunstrike coming out. But see all these how all these small intricacies just change up the game. Like, if Trixie got the Culling Blade off appropriately, he would have had the cooldown for the next Culling Blade on Fluff, and he would have also given 40 movement speed and attack speed to everybody on the team. If his first calling blade came to pass, the other targets might have survived because they would have been able to run out of range of the Rubick or chase him down faster. But unfortunately, the calling blade did
bottom
not
lane,
connect. And what is
TC,
going to connect is
there's your Sunstrike. The call down comes as well, but Invoker's already got the pick off. And Bulba, he's going to be very, very happy he's got himself this Invis rune on him. Or else he could have found himself dead as well, but I'm wondering if he's thinking about picking off Flying Llamas.
There are bats coming, and there is a Prophet.
Oh, there's a Sentry Ward, though. One leap away by the Mirana. They saw him over on the side, and they're going to roar to kill off the Courier.
Nicely done.
That's commitment.
Yeah, that's nicely done, though. I got to say, that's definitely worth it. Hindering item progression between 12 to 15 minutes. I'm not too sure if you could have best asked for a better timing than maybe for the first 3 minutes.
One thing he didn't stop, though, was that Hand of Midas arriving for the Weaver. If they picked if they picked it off before the Hand of Midas arrived, then we'd be able to say that was a lot bigger thing. Where right now, like, Trixie's nowhere near his Blink Dagger. You got a Hand of Midas up with the Invoker, so he's got 3k gold up on him, but knowing Harney, he's going to be rushing up something else. In fact, he just gets his BTs, but he'll have to go back to base to pick these suckers up.
You know what? Normally, I'm not a supporter of Hani's choice of items sometimes, but I gotta say, this BT is a very, very wise decision. Once again, we look at the mobility coming out of Liquid's heroes, and if the Evoker is there to be able to react appropriately, I mean, BTs just help them do that so much more effectively. And Midas BTs, two of the best items to help you transition into the late game, just in case anything happens. So, I'm in full support of that decision for the first time. I like Hani's build.
We'll make a note of it in our logs. Bulba on this bottom lane. This is such great positioning from him. I just want to give him props for what he just did then. A simple thing like having a ball rover on the left-hand side of the tree, because you don't have a ward there. In fact, there's an aggressive ward up from Fnatic that's watching the bottom lane. But the fact you got Bulba in the lane, farming up from around this area, and he's already got that huge area because of the axes, but can see the gang is coming, saw the two heroes on the side, still stay close enough to get that experience. And now backs up, smokes up with fluff and stuff. He's only got the ball that's caught inside of this, but there's a sentry ward over from the Radiant side, so they saw this coming. Which means this gank is not really going to work, but it's Liquid moving and trying to make the action happen. And they're going to come
now
in towards
the middle.
Now, this
is the amazing thing about Priestess, Toby, is that when you spot out a gank like that, you can also counter-initiate with
arrow
this.
From No-Tail! It connects on him as he's trying to TP out. But with the Starfall damage, the Battle Hunger, and then Axe just culling blades him down. So 36 seconds on the sideline for Bulba, after I was just praising him.
That's just the beauty of Mirana. Sometimes when you see a gank and you can escape it, you can also follow it up immediately with the Moonlight Shadow, which once
way
again,
two.
Not players are aware of or prepare for all the time. And they're taking a little bit of harassment damage from Way 2. But Way 2 is now the one that's getting pursued. Let's see if it gets caught.
Yes. Yeah, 1 second arrow only though, but you got Frostbite, Nova, and Sunstrikes on the way in. So even if CM didn't have the follow-up there, it would have been enough for the Sunstrike. But Way 2 was playing a very weird and interesting game. He was baiting the Weaver to come into the side chop, so his Familiars, which had only just stomped down, could come up and do some damage to him. Because he knew he had vision because the sentry was, so he attempted. I think he actually really attempted enough harassment to push Era out of the lane.
I think he's just trying to create a little bit more momentum and space for his team. Of course, when the support hero is zoning out the enemy carry, by trial and error and by the rule of just canceling each other out, matching things, it's a very efficient trade. But unfortunately, he got caught and cost him dearly. But he will be back. He did not lose his bat, so that's a slight positive if you want to look at it that way. Interesting item build coming out of Koipa. I am starting to see this more often ever since the Shadowblade nerf. But is it worth it still on the Prophet? I don't know. I'm having a hard time trying to figure out what the most optimal build for Prophet is. In this kind of game, the burst heal is very important because, yeah, a lot of Fnatic's damage relies on just bursting down targets and following it up with the Culling Blade. So mech is definitely a necessity. But I'm not sure if Prophet's the best candidate to pick this item up. What do you feel from all the games that you've watched?
Well, I'd feel right now that Aegis Prophet becomes a lot more of a circumstantial item. Like, if you play him like you do, like the mid-solo into utility kind of style, like, that's one option you can have. And when you have a hero like a Visage also on the field, like, you want to be able to free up that extra farm, Prophet's already going to give you a split push. If you're looking for him to do off damage and just to, like, split push through Shadowblade and through elusiveness, then that's okay. But if you want to have him split push through strength and power, then I'm a massive fan of this build as well. Profit for me is the ultimate utility hero. He can do anything and everything. So this build's fine.
Yeah, it's not so much that I'm just questioning the build. It's just I feel like, what can you get out of the build, and what kind of things can you get more out of the build? Because when I see a mecha on Prophet, and I see heroes like Beastmaster,
no tells in trouble. On this team, pick him up, throw him down. They're gonna roar as well. The Weaver Bugs are coming in with the axes and the Fade Bolt. There's enough burst damage from Liquid to get this job done. Now the time lapse out from Era Fluff and stuff, though he's got Shikuchi, so he's able to hide himself in the corner, and he can see where Weaver's moving because of their own sentry wards. But that gank was meant for the Weaver, not the Mirana.
Yeah. This is coming to that point where this is my problem with the specific item build, is that if you want to do the mech, I feel like you have to get a little bit more out of it by actually having scenarios to use it. One of those scenarios that you can force yourself to use it is when you have a hero like Beastmaster and Visage on your team, heroes like that, you can actually just go to the Roche Pit really fast and just take it out really, really quickly with a medallion or something like that on the team. And I do hope that Visage does pick it up eventually, but see, if they're trying to transition into the mid-game, late-game with those Aghanim Scepters on their heroes...
Might have to wait a moment, man. Hani's going to come up. Pulse snap. There goes your Meteorite. Koifa. A lot of damage. Meg Charge keep him alive a little bit longer, but that last attack coming in from the Invoker kills the killing spree of Team Liquid's Koifa. And the rest of Liquid will have to back up. They used the Mirana ulti to initiate in towards that one. But really, it didn't give him much of an advantage because the Sentry Ward was still down. But they did manage to catch out Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, that's once again, another fear with Prophet is that if I'm an Invoker player or a mid lane player, one of the heroes that I'm always looking to snipe out is the Prophet, because I know they don't rush BKBs. So, this mech, I really hope it pays for them very, very soon, because TC, with all those deaths to his name, he's not farming very, very well. And of course, he will have the BKB soon. But once again, we have Era, who picked up the Midas and is going to start making the money back and already getting extras out of it. Mm-hmm. And Honey, who's had that Midas forever, along with the Boots of Travel. I feel like if the game goes late, even with the Nature's Prophet on the opposition as well as the Gyrocopter, I am a little bit scared for Liquid just because of the sheer farm that Fnatic are getting on their important core heroes.
Uh-huh. I also noticed you've seen the bonus gold coming out from Trixie. He keeps coming in and cutting bleeding down these Visage's familiars. And then just follows up, and he does a lot of damage too. Just some basic attacks coming into those familiars. Way Too Sexy has lost them so many times. And that was just like his most recent resummon too. So he's got 2 minutes without these familiars. And I'm wondering what's going to happen. Well, one for Hani on top lane. As they initiate in on him, he's going to call snap. And with a couple of the familiars, Forge Spirits attacking originally there onto Koifa. Now goes over to TC. But Hani, there's no gap in the tree line to get himself out of that one. So Visage will end the dominating spree with the Soul Assumption damage. And then on bottom lane, Fluff and Stuff's on the run. He'll have support coming in from Bulba, but now Bulba, he's frostbitten up, Novid as well. There's no angle coming in for the arrow to come out from Notel, but he'll leap himself up and away from that Shikuchi. Well, I was going to say Weaver, but it's just the Rubik, and Bulba's still running himself away. Blubberstuff picks him up, throws him down. They cut the tree line off by, in fact, using that telekinesis, and Trixie's trying to catch up to Koifa. Battle Hunger movement speed will help him out with that one, but now the ball from Bulba turns around, even gets denied off there by Koifa. But it was slowing down the axe, so we had a little bit of trouble getting in close. And yeah, Koifa's now going to snipe out the T1 tower in the middle lane too. So watch the map everywhere we go.
This is one of those downsides with the Calling Blade if you use it for the Visage bats. I mean, it is an instant kill, so very, very nice to pick up. But unfortunately, the Calling Blade doesn't refresh because it's not a hero target that it's killing. So it did go on cooldown, and of course, without the Invoker's support there, they didn't have much to keep the fight going against Liquid. But I think it's just beginning to show. Bulba is extremely tanky, and Fnatic are lacking damage without the Invoker. But at the same time, it seems like both teams could just get more out of it. And it's unfortunate because Hani at the top lane, if he just clicked a little bit better for that instance, because what he did was he queued up Deafening Blast instead of Ghost Walk by accident, and that kind of got him killed. So yeah, that's probably just a harassment attempt. He knows that this Gucci is online.
Yeah. But funny thing is, though, he followed it up by using a Mirana ultimate, which he didn't need to get away. He had his movement speed to do that.
I was actually thinking so that Fluff might try to turn around and steal it.
It was for middle lane. Trixie's coming in close, and he'll get the call. So he's got the call up. He's holding the Visage in position. There's enough damage there. No, it's not enough to do the Culling Blade fully. Sunstrike's coming in with the Meteorite too. Bulba's Axe will pick up Trixie and Koifa. Four-staffed in to help out with a little extra right-click damage. But they lose the Visage for picking up both the Axe and Weaver. And now also moving over towards Roshan.
Oh, that's such a nice move by Liquid there. I mean, I think Era kind of misjudged the scenario by trying to return there without the... Well, he had time last ready, but I don't think it was in the back of his mind to just immediately cast it. So he got caught up by Bubble's Roar there. Boba kind of yelled at him and put him down to the ground. And of course, the Sunstrike is coming out to spot that out, but I think Hani knows the scenario situation, saying that, yeah, I probably can't contest that. And he's so close to his sheep stick, which I assume he's going for.
Yeah.
So I don't think he wants to take any risks in that manner. And TC getting that Roche is a relatively big deal now because he has the BKB, he has the Helm of Dominator. In the next fight, if you didn't see how much damage he already did, he's going to do a ton more with that extra life.
Yeah, when you finally see these gyros move themselves up from I need to survive the fight first and then you need to do damage during the fight, that's kind of like that moment where you almost hope you got like your damage shielding item at the same time you got your mech, aka about 15 minutes into the game, and then you would just steamroll over absolutely everything. And like way too sexy, he's getting close towards Zag and Interceptor, so we're going to rack up a lot more damage coming out from him soon as well. Because Beastmaster's had a lot of time too, we got 3 points up in his inner beast already. So he's almost maxed out of his abilities when he's 13 levels in and having an Agonim Scepter up and running and still having another 1600 gold too. They're going to smoke, they're going to move, they're going to try and find kills. This is just a very active Liquid on the map. I'm enjoying watching these guys play. And maybe they can find a kill on Trixie. The smoke just got revealed off on way too sexy. He came a little bit too close to Trixie, and Trixie, well, blink in. Fluff's got that, drags Trixie back. There's your roar out from Bulba, but Trixie spin did a lot of damage there to Bulba, and Trixie's only on a half life, four stomped in close, and then just destroys the Rubik, who also had himself a dominating spree, and Bulba won't get out this one safely either. Like I said, it was nice to watch. Doesn't seem like it's that nice for Liquid right now.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I'm not too sure what Liquid was doing there. They saw the Vanguard on Trixie, and they see that he has the cloak as well as the four staff. He's extremely tanky and not susceptible to any sort of damage at all. All Liquid had in that fight was pretty much Visage Nuke as well as Bulba's Roar to secure a bit of damage. And all they had was that initial burst damage coming out from the spells and plus the Rubik's Fade Bolt. That did not contribute enough at all. So I'm not sure if they probably should have been aware that the Vanguard will shut down all the forms of right clicks at this point, blocking 80% for 40 damage. And I'm just surprised that they attempted that in the first place because they didn't have Koipa or TC. And even if Koipa was there, looking at his items, I'm doubting that Koipa does enough damage. So going on pretty much the hardest target to go on right now on the side of Fnatic and in front of their tier 2 tower when you saw TP rotations coming in, not the wisest decision out of Liquid. And of course, TC still has everything that he had, but giving up slight advantages like that here and there, Fnatic are going to catch up very safely, but very sound and very fast.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's just... I can't believe this lineup has worked as well as it has.
Which one?
Fnatic's.
I see the synergy, but once again, it's like at the top lane, I feel like an ample number of things could have gone better for them. But
Definitely.
Do agree.
Definitely.
You know, I have been speaking to Liquid rather often, and basically, even though, once again, they're on like a 16-game winning streak or so, one of the things that they struggle often with, I feel like, is their complacency with their games. A lot of times, their players are very content with just farming up around the map, which is why you said something interesting about how much map movement they were giving to against Fnatic. Like, they were just walking around the enemy jungle and looking for kills nonstop. And sometimes it gets the better of them, like that scenario with the axe at the bottom just now.
Mm-hmm.
But if they get too complacent, on the other hand, what's going to happen is, in this farming
fluff.
Game, Fnatic have two Midases, and Fluff...
That was really, really nice movement. Orca came in from Nature's Prophet as well. But Notar was moving himself around, doing the ward block onto the Ancient area, realizing obviously when you got a gyre on the field, you need to stop that from happening. But he leapt himself in, and then that Blink Dagger coming out from the Rubik, combining it up with also the Leap from Mirana. He moved in quick. He got the control with Telekinesis, and then allowed Koifa to TP himself in, put off the Orchid, and then the damage was too easy to pick off the Mirana. Just nice, quick, jumping movement from Liquid.
Yeah. Nice rotations coming out of Liquid. Let's just hope that they really can keep it up, because at this point, you give any more room to Fnatic, once again, they will capitalize and take it a mile. So, right now, they're farming up their own jungle. Way Too Sexy, however, has the Aghanim Scepter, and we all know the power of the Visage with triple bats. Even against the Axe, if the bats are not in the proximity of the counter Helix, those bats will wreck, absolutely destroy supports, and even the Weaver, who is pretty squishy to right-click, so...
Yeah.
Fnatic will have to be relatively careful, but Liquid, now on the hunt with the Smoke Gank, which no longer is seen by anything on the map, unless the smoke is revealed, so... Let's see if they can catch out Honey, who is farming the jungle. He's getting pinged out.
Hawk let him see it. Fluff actually blinks himself into the tree line, which he'll break with the telekinesis drop down and the cooldown as well. That was commitment to make sure Unfoga died straight away. Even Coifus positioning. Oh, Trixie. Sentry wards are there. They can see Fluff and stuff quite clearly. He leads himself away and out of range of Fly's ultimate. And now the arrow comes in from the side, allows the Culling Blade to then go into effect. So it becomes a one-for-one trade, but you've just lost your Invoker for your Rubick. And you're bailing out very, very quickly. This will now be a push down the middle lane coming out from Liquid.
Yeah. Liquid did lose their Rubick, but they know, once again, that trade was in their favor times 100. So with TC with the Aegis still and picking up the Talisman of Evasion, which I assume leads me to believe that it's going to be the Butterfly next. And now the Sprout coming out as well as the Arrow, but yeah, Fnatic's not going to get too much done here, so
yeah.
Trixie's going to try to drop some casual Battle Hungers here and there, but the tower is definitely a goner. And the only question is, are they going to go for more?
There's your ult. Into the cooldown. And a very quick death to the Axe. And I think TC almost didn't move from that arrow on purpose as well. He's got this Aegis model that's about to be reclaimed, so he's going to get his life and mana back anyway. So he's just sat on the front line saying, please attack me with everything you've got. Please initiate in. And Liquid, there was just one person. The Axe was just a little bit too far away. And they could just initiate on him.
Yeah. That roar with that 900, 1000 range initiation. So good for picking off targets that are slightly off guard.
Quiver now, well, you want to know if his build was going to work, dude. Four staff has been going overtime for him with the Orchid, with the mech, but now has a 5.5k gold. So, a straight scythe of vice possibilities there. Notel turns around. They found Flopper Stuff. Arrow's going to connect. Rubick, a little bit too over-aggressive in his movement. The Observer Wall, which is a little bit further down the river, is what spotted him.
We see this happen pretty much every single game Liquid's involved in. This is just the effects of playing with fire and the dual-edged swordness of, well, I'm not sure if that's even a term, but just the double-edged side of a sword. I'm having a difficulty to put into words, but basically, it's just what happens when a support player is always trying to look for plays and trying to set things up for the team, is that sometimes you get punished because you are out of position alone. And oftentimes you require to be out of position alone in order to look for those big plays or some of those unexpected plays coming out. So yeah, sometimes you get caught, sometimes you catch and you win, but it's a toss-up.
And something which is tossed the way of Liquid. We're getting out the Butterfly over from the Gyro, and it was a straight side of the Vice Rush up. While Fnatic, they're using Mirana ultimate to come in to see Roshan, but Roshan is nowhere near spawn time yet. Like, he's not even in the potential zone for spawn time yet. So I'm not quite sure what Fnatic thought Liquid were up to, unless they got their timings a little bit wrong. I know some people are still having trouble adjusting to the new timer of Roshan. Oh, Familiars, how many can you pick off? Fluff and stuff, he jumped in so quickly then! Grabbing up! Notel. So the Mirana's on the sidelines now. TC with the Oldman. First rocket. Oh, won't even hit on anybody, but the bugs were stolen. So got the negative armor and that harassment damage coming out the way to Tahani. And they're going to find Trixie over on the side. Coip with a double kill. Nate Charge keeping everybody up. I think they managed to go off twice during that engagement. But the homing missile chasing down Hani. They've got him locked. Blink in by Fluffersup. Controls him up. Fade Bolt damage as well. With the Rocket Barrage. Quirk for jumps in. Triggers off the Linker Sphere of Era first with the Sprouts. And he can follow with the Orchid. And Era will pop from the Orchid damage too. Everybody dying. There is a buyback coming out from Axe. But Koifa has already picked himself up an Ultra Kill. And Liquid will look to take this first game completely beyond contention. And just push out this tier 1, this tier 3 tower down the mid. Take out the Rax. And put Liquid on their backs.
Man, I gotta say, that outcome as a whole is not something I expected at all. Of course, Fnatic getting caught out of position in that teamfight and continuously getting out of caught inside their own base even in this scenario. It just happened all so fast that I didn't really see the outcome very coming off so quickly. But
same.
It's just, I don't know what to say. I mean, I was watching that fight and the majority of Fnatic heroes are running and they're all using their spells. And I don't really want to bash down on one player, but Hani, who has a lot put on his role with the Evoker, who's been farming all game, he did not cast Decisive Eyes. He was so focused on the idea that he can get a Chaos Meteor combo off that he kept the Meteor on for the majority of the runaway. And did not cast Deafening Blast to follow up with the Tornado, did not cast himself the Ghostwalk, and unfortunately he just fell inside of his own base. So at the end of the day, some of their picks working out nicely at certain parts of the game, but otherwise not paying off in the team fights as they need to. And yeah, Liquid take that victory very convincingly from what seemed to be somewhat of an even game.
Yeah, man, it's I put it on the other side of the thing. It's like, well, okay, Hani's got his things, but I still saw Rubick, who had some of the best initiation, even getting caught out a couple of times, but with the jump-ins, the telekinesis grabs, the ability to actually use the Mirana Leap as well, then he had Nature's Prophet with his follow-up, Beastmaster, Aghanim Scepter. It's really difficult. Like, you saw those last, like, the two separate, like, starts to the engagements. Like, the first one, which happened at the middle lane, when Nortel got caught out as the Mirana, and then the follow-up, which then ended up happening when they went through the tier 3 towers, and then again it was this jump in onto the Mirana. But you got such range in a Roar, you got such range in a Rubick's initiation, you got Prophet coming anywhere on the map. Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Dota 2 Championship League live stream. I'm going to say welcome back because it has been a while since I've actually been on this live stream. Traveling down to Korea, casting up some really awesome games down there, but now I'm back here in my studio in Berlin to stream out the match for you to this evening. In fact, we've got two matches coming to you tonight. We're going to be starting off with, Team Liquid going up against Fnatic, and the following game will be Alliance going up against Sigma. Now, both these games are normally meant to be best of threes, but both Alliance and Sigma, because it is a deciding matchup depending who goes into the semifinals and who goes into the quarterfinals. Both teams decided with a great time limit as well, which is imposed on them with a whole bunch of different tournaments. They'll be playing their game as a best of one tonight. So we have a best of three and a best of one coming for you tonight. Of course, we do have our teams coming up on the board. My American co-caster, who's not actually that American, we found out earlier before, Clairvoyance Man, welcome to your broadcast.
All right, man, Toby, it's always good to be here. Always good to be able to watch some of the best Dota available in the Western scene and see the development of these teams and see how they fold just before some of the biggest events coming up for you this year, post TI3 into TI4. And you know, when you think of tier 1 names, we see something like Team Liquid, which has been on a complete domination path, just destroying everybody in their way, maybe barring Na'Vi and Alliance. Those are the two teams that they always say they have struggles with. But everybody else, I think their latest record is something like 16-0. And they've just been crushing everyone that's been standing in their path. As for Fnatic, something of a similar story, I would like to say. Having a little bit of trouble with Na'Vi and Alliance, as with every other team. But even Na'Vi and Alliance have trouble with Na'Vi and Alliance. But basically, yeah, they've been on a roll pretty much, taking out a lot of wins. I think they've been facing EG up a lot lately. And they've been doing pretty decent on that front. Beating Speed, I think, the other day, as well as a couple other teams here and there. But very interesting set of bans coming out, too, because with the new patch, I'm not sure if you got a chance to play the new heroes, but all I got to say is you toss those spirits into this metagame before MLG Columbus, and if that happens, disaster will ensue.
I'm pretty sure they won't get themselves in. Like, yeah, all new heroes, they have to go through the test of the pubs before we find out if they are balanced or not. Also, speaking of balance, sorry guys, I realized the music was a little bit too loud before while we're chatting. As I said before, I'm keeping my eyes peeled for all the possible technical issues which could be arising because some wonderful people have fiddled with my settings. So, not everything is as balanced as it normally was before.
Ah, fiddlesticks. That's a nice League of Legends.
There was a great movie, and there was someone that said a line, I just don't like people touching my things! I don't know what it is.
But it has a very Forrest Gumpy vibe to it.
No, it's definitely not Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump would never get angry like that. He'd never get all angry. Right. He's like, my things, people Liquid's be touching my things.
Wow. Well, I'm not sure if that can be invoked. Alright, I tried that. Never mind, I'm not even going to go with you.
Attempted
pun. All I can say is, Focus the next draft, Toby. And I got to say, that's a hero that Hani's been playing rather often lately. Mm-hmm. To moderate success, I'd like to say. Something like pretty much goes even in the mid-game or pardon me, not the mid game, pretty much goes even in the mid lane rather often, and then proceeds to get a lot of farm and a lot of nice items with the Blink Dagger and the Seldom Force Staff, as well as the Aghanim Scepter and all the other things that he needs. And yeah, starts to dish out a lot of spells, a lot of magical burst damage coming out, as well as disables, lockdown. This hero has 10 spells available in his arsenal, so a lot of different possibilities and combinations. But what really ticks me is that Liquid are giving a lot of respect to Fnatic Wisp, and it's something that's always been talked of. No-Tail's Wisp is definitely up there as the best, if not one of the best. And a hero that's kind of fallen out, but still getting mentioned. It means that things have been in the woodworks with these players going against each other in scrims and giving respect to each other and saying, you know, I've seen you draft that hero not just once or twice. I've seen you play it effectively against us with specific strategies. I'm going to rule it out and give ourselves the best chance. And Liquid, picking up the Nature's Prophet as the first pick, and Fnatic with that bold second pick in Volker. I must say, I'm a little bit surprised that there has been no mention of Clockwork, Bounty Hunter, or Timbersaw in the first drafting stage.
It's like they almost completely ignored their offlane until this point. It's kind of funny considering the last game that I cast, which was the DK versus Alliance game, and most of the time they just focused on banning up against that offlaner. It's the hardest lane to control in the current patch. Like, what are you really supposed to do up against, like, these Clockworks and Timbersaw or off lanes kind of thing? It's a rough life. It's a rough life. That's actually kind of what I like Fnatic with their pickup of Invoker. It's this hero which, like, most people got used to playing up against him a couple of months ago. And now, not many people play up against Invoker. Not many people still play the Invoker on a solo mid. And can you really say there is a straight-up direct counter to the Invoker in the middle lane at any time?
I guess it's kind of a hard one, but I do think that there are some heroes that do exceptionally well against a hero in general. I know for one that, pardon me, I know for one that if Liquid see Invoker being picked up by Fnatic, they have never hesitated to take either the Elder Titan, which is banned, of course, or the Beastmaster as the second option. And you know what, looking at Liquid's draft right now, the Bats and the Nature's Prophet with the Split Push and Beastmaster's Range of Initiation, that's looking to be a really, really good hero. So I'm not too sure if Liquid's going to pass up on the Beastmaster. I really do feel like they're going to take it, especially with the Weaver and the Fray now. You want that extra bit of lockdown that you can get before the Lincolns, and even after the Lincolns, it still helps. So, yeah, I'm feeling a Beastmaster pick coming out relatively soon. I would say not saved up to the last pick, but maybe the fourth pick.
Is Tuka with the Beastmaster?
Yeah, I do. I do smell Beastmaster. I think they've just been playing it against Honey's Invoker every single time, and, you know,
I'll be waiting for the Pugner and the Chen really coming out from Liquid. Like I look at you're right. You're 100% right. I should never doubt my co-casters ever.
No. I like the idea that you had, because obviously with the Chen, and it actually completely passed me, is that with the Chen, you could have done a lot of early game pushing. And Invoker, one of the reasons he actually fell off before all the nerfs hit him really, really hard is that he was very, very susceptible to pushes, not just ganks. Invoker is a pretty tough cookie to take down, you know, with the X Sword and the Quas giving you intelligence and base strength. It makes you a little bit tanky, gives you that extra regen, but definitely is very susceptible to pushing. And Nature's Prophet and Beastmaster is just another form of that pushing, just comes in a later stage.
Yeah. It's still possible we see portions of it. Like, you can run Pugner on the safe lane, so you can still do it, and then have your inner beast aura to help out with all of that. But I was also thinking on like the double effect. Like, you got the Invoker, as you're talking about, like, you can push up against him, but then you get Weaver, a guy who needs time to find farm. Now you also get a Mirana into the pool for Fnatic, and unless that's a support Mirana and it becomes a carry Mirana, you need space for that Mirana to get farm to do some decent damage, because you can find yourself sitting there with the Maelstrom and you've lost all your out of towers, and you're like, well, what kind of damage can I dish to push everybody back out of the lanes? Give us some space to farm. It just doesn't exist anymore. So that's the main reason why I was thinking the Pugner. It was also because my brain and my meta is still tainted by the weekend and the 14-minute push which came out from DK.
Yeah. Pugna definitely be really strong in that. You know, I thought as soon as I saw Pugna being picked up religiously ever since the beginning of this new patch, I was thinking to myself, wow, this hero either looks silly stupid or ridiculously broken. And by silly stupid, I mean, like, yeah, it's broken in a sense, but kind of a weird way. It's like if you build the Necrobook really fast, you're just going to take out towers and stuff. But it's a very, and I know this word is just overused these days, but it's a very niche pick. Like, it's a pick that you pick it first, and pretty much the rest of the draft is very, very obvious what you're going to aim for, because you're not going to pick a Pugna and then try to pick a hard carry on the safe lane and and get a greedy offlaner like that, because maybe trying to mix in a little bit of push and a little bit of farm, it just doesn't come, because Pugna just offers you so much on that offensive front that you want to just go over the top with it. So most of the time, you just end up seeing all these all-in pushes kind of thing where the Pugna kind of loses past 30, 40, although Pugna can transition pretty nicely with items. And I got to say, lately, all I've seen is if I don't see the Pugna being mentioned in the first four picks, and by then there's already four bans as well, then it's probably going to get omitted. So Liquid's going for the Rubick now. I guess it's preventing the Beastmaster steal, but also it gives a lot of different potential abilities that the Rubick can take, namely the Scoochie coming out of the Weaver. It's always a fantastic ability for Rubick's initiation. And the Luna getting banned out by Fnatic, so they are absolutely aware of what Liquid's lineup can potentially bring to them. So I think that Luna ban is a fantastic call. And I'm just curious to see what Liquid's last pickup is going to be.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it too, Matt. Can you keep going for a moment? I just realized something else in the big point battle is not going 100% right. So I'm having to modify some stuff for that one.
I see. Well, Fnatic is going to be picking up their last hero in a few moments, because they don't have too much time on their draft left. They have about 10 seconds on the previous as well as 11 on the reserve time. And right now, I feel like they have a lot of magical sources and good escape and survivability. There's a lot of well-rounded stuff, but what I really feel like is they need a tank initiation bruiser type of hero, something that can just go in, start the fight. This Invoker, Weaver, Mirana lineup is very reminiscent of a Tidehunter, but Axe is going to be their choice for the initiation. The brute force that is tanking up everything at the front lines is going to be the Axe, and I'm not too sure how well Axe will do against the majority of Liquid's lineup, which is pretty range int heavy based. And of course, Battle Hunger is known to reap through that very nicely, along with the Berserker's Call. If he can get it off is the problem though. So if the Axe is going for an early Blink Dagger, this game might change its pace very, very quickly. But if the Axe cannot get into the range of initiation, at best he's good for soaking up damage, and frankly, Axe is not exactly the best at that without tanky items. So sure. Axe has always been a toss-up that way.
See, I'm looking at it from this perspective of just like pure laning, and I know too from also the previous perspective that no Axes these days are even going anywhere near Berserker's Call until like level 8 or 9. Then they start to touch on that. So I'm thinking early game laning, they want to try and pin the Axe up against Nature's Prophet. That way, at least, there's no harassment damage Prophet could do directly towards Axe, because tree damage is okay, but the chance of a spin is probably going to be better for you as an Axe. But that means you've got to throw an extra supporter up there just to make sure he's okay. So if they run something like a CM Axe, and then put Mirana on the bottom lane pulling to help out the Weaver on the bottom lane, or switch the supports around and then Invoker for the solo mid, I'm really interested to see how Fnatic want to try and find their synergy and how strong that's going to be in their lanes too, because a CM and Axe is like, well, that's okay, but both of them have escape mechanisms up against a Rubick who's got telekinesis control, Visage, you've got Grave Chill control, and then you've got Bulb who can rotate in with level 6 as well, so that's going to cause more issues later on. And on top of that, now we add a Gyro to the mix who, if we want to say there's a homing missile up his sleeve, we've got a TP in from Coit for on his Nature's Prophet into a Sprout, all these different things which Liquid have. The control is just so much better for them, as well as what it seems to be, the lanes seem to be a lot better for them as well.
Yeah, and my mind is on the lanes as well. I mean, lately, all the acts that we've seen, or from what I've seen anyway, has something to do with creep skipping and trying to get that early advantage by trying to abuse the hero the best way you can. Of course, he's a strength hero, a lot of good HP value. His armor is not the best, but most of the time that's going to be mitigated, or that's going to be consolidated by the stealth shield that he picks up. And with the clarity in his inventory, I do feel like, yeah, Trixie's Axe is going to look to be very, very aggressive from early on. So I'm curious to see how this will pan out. But I do slightly fear that this hero, known for his ability to snowball, no matter how many heroes you can dunk, it doesn't necessarily contribute towards pushing towers. And of course, I know Fnatic that they have a lot of damage, a fair bit of damage coming out from Hani with the X-Sword as well as a couple other heroes. But let's see if it can successfully turn the tides of multiple team fights and transition into something from a snowball into an avalanche. Because right now, I got to be a Debbie Downer here and say I'm doubting this Axe pick. I'm not sure if it's going to be very successful, but here comes the rotation, Toby, from Fnatic. The Fnatic train with the Axe going towards mid lane and top lane.
Yeah, so they're gonna try and do this with an aggressive tri lane. Leave Ira by himself up against, at this point, it's way too sexy, but it should be Coitfa at the end of the day. Yeah, he's going to summon new Sentries and head down south. So they could be... No, in fact, they're going to leave Sentry Wars down here. So Liquid's already cottoned on to the fact of what's going on. Way too early for the Sentry Worlds at the bottom, so they can watch Era's Weaver, who gets possibly the most redundant rune he could ever get, which is going to be the Invis rune. Middle lane will then fly on the Crystal Maiden. Harney is the Invoker, so they're going to start this with a dual lane, or at least dual to block it up. Bulbit will be the Beastmaster here in the middle lane. It puts Way Too Sexy on a rotation up with a Visage towards the top lane to join his other support player, Fluff and Stuff, as the Rubick for Team Liquid, and they're babysitting TC, who's farming up as the Gyro. And then we get our off lane, which is, it's going to be Axe and the Mirana. So the support heroes did switch up from what I was thinking they might do, but it's still Trixie on the front lines. Tango's Salve, Stout Shield, and let's see how much he can tank, and let's see how long he can survive, because already Fluff and Stuff's going to force him out. And Quaver on this bottom lane, too. I'm interested to see how well he's going to go down here. Like, you got Sentry Wars down there, so you at least got yourself some vision and some extended vision time over on Era. But how well is Era going to be able to tank up against that harassment from Nature's Prophet, especially when the trees start doing this? They get taken off and pushing directly and attacking on the Weaver directly.
Yeah, pardon my pause for there for a moment. I had a slight cough there for a second. But yeah, with the Sentry Wards, this Prophet versus Weaver has always been a critical matchup. So I'm surprised how Era's going to do up as well, because with the Sentry Wards, all of a sudden becomes that much more difficult. And when Sprout is online, or when three treants are coming out of Nature's Call, we can already see that Quaver's getting so much more out of this lane, because the lane's already pushed up from the start, giving him a lot more room for maneuverability to just walk around the map and abuse his superior range against a hero like Weaver. So Quaver doing a really, really good job right now, and all of a sudden I'm beginning to understand why the early Prophet pick came up, Alliance-style kind of play.
It's just a hero, man, that you can't turn down. You can't turn down Nature's Prophet at any point. What he brings to the game, and the ability to also have like a plan B with Prophet, and while he's still a very strong plan A, you just can't pass that kind of stuff up. I don't see how teams can pass it up.
Yeah, man, just the fact that you have the summons, the global TP, and massive burst nuke ultimate that can kind of be used for farming as well. There's just so many purposes that this hero can provide, and Battle Hunger coming out for the first time at the top lane, I believe. Way Too Sexy's the one that's getting caught of the fire. But let's see if TC can give his support a kill here. And looks like he's just going to tank up the damage.
Unfortunately, even with the Battle Hunger up, like this one, I'm not really getting the synergy of this top lane. Like, Battle Hunger, that's great. You're going to get some extra movement speed for Trixie. Gets in, gets out. I suppose that's a nice little part of that one. And hey! You didn't see that one either. Cold snap.
I completely missed that one. I'm actually surprised that came down. I mean, it was a rotation from the CM. That's understandable.
Oh, top lane. This is what we were waiting for. Trixie to get into telekinesis, rocket barrage back up again, Fade Bolt and Soul Assumption damage. That's what we were both waiting for that top lane.
Yeah, and I know what you were getting at. Like, the lack of commitment in this lane. I mean, it's fine for an Axe to just dish out a spell and drop harassment damage, but what's the point of harassment damage if the enemy team knows that you can actually not touch them at all? Like, we know with the Gyrocopter in the lane, this Axe is getting nowhere near the supports. You're not going to tank Rocket Barrage level 2 damage and survive that outcome. There is no way. So this Battle Hunger at best is doing just a little bit of tickling here and there, and not much else of anything else.
I could be really depressed now. I got to restart my counter. 2.5 weeks without missing a first blood, even through the entire Dota 2 Invitational when I was there casting on the main stage of G-Star. Still didn't miss the first blood. I come back to Berlin. It's good to see. We're back to our roots, people. We're back to our roots.
I'm telling you, man. It's the co-cast factor. Just told me I'm too strong, man. What can I say?
I thought the co-cast factor is the co-caster meant to look out for you.
What? When?
So the co-caster's like, yo, man, middle lane, they're going to get themselves a kill.
No, of course not, Toby. I knew it was happening, but I did not want to interrupt you. You know what I'm saying?
I said to high level bullshit. Koifa getting pushed off this bottom lane. He's got phase boost now up and running, so this bottom lane completely changes around now. With the phase boost up on Koifa, we see it time and time again from this guy. The second he can go full on aggressive on his off lane, he'll do it. While I'm also keeping an eye on that middle lane again. So Flyer's coming in with smoke and Bulba. They want him to walk down a little bit further, and now they can do this. So this will be Frostbite. They're going to go for the Cold Snap, and then following it up with the Cold Snap, in with the extra damage. There's no Forge Spirits this time around, so Bulb was able to escape Harney. Possibility to invoke a Sunstriper. It's only at level 2, so it wouldn't be enough to pick up Bulba. And Bulba pops the Regeneration Rune. So gank unsuccessful.
Yeah, I think there were an ample number of things that Fnatic could have done better there. For one, you could have probably waited out the Nova duration a little bit more, or talked about when the Frostbite was really going to happen. Because Hani had the Forge Spirits up coming up near the end there, and he did not cast it. And also, his Cold Snap, if you noticed, like, the intervals didn't really hit at very critical moments. Like, the thing with Cold Snap is you have to actually cast it when one of your attack animations is in the air, so it'll trigger the next stun instance immediately. And what ended up happening was, after the Cold Snap, there was no attack animations in the air, so instead of a potential 3-4 stuns coming out, the Cold Snap only did work for about 2 stuns.
Trixie, you're so totally toast on the top lane, man. Like, then again, he's doing a lot of damage to TC, needed a couple more spins then, but gets held up in Koipa's Sprout, and way too sexy just comes in with the last bit of Soul Assumption damage, and TC, he'll survive that Battle Hunger as well. Guys, apologies, live stream dropped, I don't know what was going on, seems the server we were connected into wasn't too great. And we ended up losing some frames and dropped. But now, changed it up, so we're all good to go. Everything seems to be stable again.
Things are A-okay, Toby. Once again, back from Korea. Back to business.
Back to business. Back to my wonderful studio and how everything's meant to work.
Yeah, come on, Toby. Holidays are over. Please, you do not get to sleep at 8 in the evening anymore.
Well, actually, I almost did tonight. Oh, way too. No, there's enough. There's just no damage from this Murano. If this was like a normal 6-minute Murano, leap in.
I don't know about that leap.
It may be enough damage. Trixie's coming in really, really deep. They got enough to kill the Gyro, but now Bulba's rotation up. Trixie gets hit by Prophet Ultman as well, who seems to have picked up the Weaver on the bottom lane. And now into Battle Hunger, but he's going to get roared up. There's not enough spins to save him from this. So 3 Eras for the price of 1. The Gyro on the top lane. When Weaver goes down, diving underneath the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane, it looks to be.
Oh my, that Weaver death is going to cost them big. Because Era still had time-lapse in that situation. And of course he didn't get to use it, obviously. But giving that solo kill to Koipa, that is going to cost them. I'm not too sure if he can come back from this lane anymore. Koipa decides to not stay in the jungle, or he's farming up the jungle to get an extra bit of gold, which is understandable because he's so close to his Midas. But if he just stays in the lane and zones out Era further, Era's going to have a really, really hard time recovering, because we know that Weaver, single target hero with not many abilities to flash farm, doesn't catch up all that well as he snowballs.
I'm just making a note on my side for the drop time so we can fix the problem next time.
Note to self, Weaver does not come back. Snowballs well.
No, I wasn't making a note for that one, but even though that's a good thing to make a note about, no, it's the server drop time. Fly, you're in a lot of trouble. Crystal Maiden, Frostbite is possible, but then again, if you can't see anything, you can't really do much about it. So a quick Nova, and Koipa will get the kill over to Crystal Maiden. It was just rotating into the jungle and found too many heroes, both Fluff and Koipa hanging around.
Yep, and in the meanwhile, a nice slam down coming out of Trixie, a very simple gank executed, just a nice arrow being landed by No-Tail, followed up by the Axe, just chasing down the target, and once the Battle Hunger and the right-click did enough damage, boom, right into the sinker, the Axe of Justice.
Ira's gonna try and commit to Fluff and stuff. Shikuching up, there's no sentry ward this high up, but the second he saw TC, he backed up. But Fluff and stuff gets his pick up and a throw back on Ira, but he's still got time-lapse available. He just didn't want to take that risk coming in too close on a jar and getting telekinesis into that kind of burst damage. Top lane, we're going again. Yeah, familiar stun, so it's going to make it impossible for him to keep up. Nice arrow from No-Tail. It's a good 5-second stun, but with that Prophet ultimate damage again coming in to combine it with the Visage damage, there's just not enough stability on that top lane.
Mm-hmm. I wish I saw...
Fly, dead. Call down, telekinesis dragged and smack bang into the middle of it, and the second rocket takes him out like a nuke.
Yeah, so pardon me if I'm wrong, but I really wish I saw a bit more attempts on Sunstrikes coming out of Hani this game. He's been playing rather stale at the mid lane. Of course, the mid lane being the two position that's played as one these days, it's understandable that if you pick up the Midas, you kind of want to farm, but his battle involvement and just involvement in general, I feel like it could be better with a little bit more awareness of the surroundings. Like, a lot of targets, like for example, even the 5-second arrow at top, that could have done a lot of work with the Sunstrike. If it hit the Visage, what it would have done is put Visage in the threshold for Culling Blade and allow Trixie to follow it up. And unfortunately, Trixie's now gonna get followed up on.
Yep, there's your roar off the initiation from the Sprout and Fluff and stuff. If he wants a telekinesis, he can, but he's gonna Fade Bolt to kill Secure. That's a good thing he did too, because that allows him to have enough money to finish up the Arcane Boot. So he helps everybody by doing so.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like Hany's putting a lot of focus into the mid lane when his team needs some global backup right now, and he has the potential to do so. So,
but you can't really blame him for not trying to go for these kills. Like, fluff and stuff's an option for him. Middle lane, way too sexy. Like, he'll get picked off here in the middle lane. The way to also purposefully put some extra points up in that Gravekeeper's Cloak at the very early levels. So he knows it's a very, very tanky hero to try and bring down anyway.
Yeah, of course, the recent patch did nerf him, so he kind of needs the Gravekeepers to keep up in the early levels. And then, of course, later on, he gets extremely tanky.
Oh, nice arrow. 5 seconds on the Bulba. Sunstrike, there's what you're asking for, coming down. Even gets its Nile on the tower, and Cunning Blade is now possible. No, it's too early! Just a second too early. He's still got the spin off, Fae Bolt Fly. He's in a little bit more trouble. Fluff and stuff. He had Amelia's way too sexy. He's lost them so many times. And that was just like his most recent resummon, too. So he's got 2 minutes without these familiars. And I'm wondering what's going to happen. Well, one for Hany on top lane. As they initiate it on him, he's going to call snap and with a couple of the familiars, Carp Forge Spirits, attacking originally there onto Koifa. Now goes over to TC. But Hany, there's no gap in the tree line to get himself out of that one. So Visage will end the dominating spree with the Soul Assumption damage. And then on bottom lane, Fluff and Stuff's on the run. He'll have support coming in from Bulba, but now Bulba, he's frostbitten up, Novid as well. There's no angle coming in for the arrow to come out from Notel, but he'll leap himself up and away from that Shikuchi. Well, I was going to say Weaver, but it's just the Rubik, and Bulba's still running himself away. Fluff and Stuff picks him up, throws him down. They cut the tree line off by, in fact, using that telekinesis, and Trixie's trying to catch up to Koifa. Battle Hunger movement speed will help him out with that one, but now the ball from Bulba turns around, even gets denied off there by Koifa. But it was slowing down the axe, so he had a little bit of trouble getting in close. And yeah, Koifa's now going to snipe out the T1 tower in the middle lane too. So watch the map everywhere we go.
This is one of those downsides with the Calling Blade if you use it for the Visage Bats. I mean, it is an instant kill, so very, very nice to pick up. But unfortunately, the Calling Blade doesn't refresh because it's not a hero target that it's killing. So it did go on cooldown, and of course without the invoker support there, they didn't have much to keep the fight going against Liquid. But I think it's just beginning to show. Bulba is extremely tanky, and Fnatic are lacking damage without the invoker. But at the same time, it seems like both teams could just get more out of it, and it's unfortunate because Hany at the top lane, if he just clicked a little bit better for that instance, because what he did was he queued up Deafening Blast instead of Ghost Walk by accident, and that kind of got him killed. So yeah, that's probably just a harassment attempt. He knows that this Gucci is online.
Yeah, but funny thing is though, he followed it up by using a Morana ultimate, which he didn't need to get away. He had his movement speed to do that.
I was actually thinking so that Fluff might try to turn around and steal it.
It was from middle lane. Trixie's coming in close and he'll get the call. So he's got the call up, he's holding the Visage in position. There's enough damage there. No, it's not enough to do the Culling Blade fully. Sunstrike's coming in with the Meteorite too. Bulba's Axe will pick up Trixie and Koifa. Four-staffed in to help out with a little of extra right-click damage. But they lose the Visage for picking up both the Axe and Weaver. And now also moving over towards Roshan.
Oh, that's such a nice move by Liquid there. I mean, I think Era kind of misjudged the scenario by trying to return there he had time last ready, but I don't think it was in the back of his mind to just immediately cast it. So he got caught up by Bubba's Roar there. Bulba kind of yelled at him and put him down to the ground. And of course, the Sunstrike is coming out to spot that out, but I think Hany knows this scenario situation, saying that, yeah, I probably can't contest that. And he's so close to his sheep stick, which I assume he's going for.
Yeah.
So I don't think he wants to take any risks in that manner. And TC getting that Roche is a relatively big deal now because he has the BKB, he has the Helm of Dominator. In the next fight, if you didn't see how much damage he already did, he's going to do a ton more with that extra life.
Yeah, when you finally see these gyros move themselves up from I need to survive the fight first, and then you need to do damage during the fight, that's kind of like that moment where you almost hope you got like your damage healing item at the same time you got your mech, aka about 15 minutes into the game, and then you would just steamroll over absolutely everything. And like way too sexy, he's getting close towards Zag and Interceptor, so we're going to rack up a lot more damage coming out from him soon as well. Because Beastmaster's had a lot of time too, we've got 3 points up in his inner beast already. So he's almost maxed out of his abilities when he's 13 levels in and having an Aghanim Scepter up and running and still having another 1600 gold too. They're going to smoke, they're going to move, they're going to try and find kills. This is just a very active Liquid on the map. I'm enjoying watching these guys play. And maybe they can find a kill on Trixie. The smoke just got revealed off on way too sexy. He came a little bit too close to Trixie, and Trixie, blink in. Fluff's got that. Drags Trixie back. There's your roar out from Bulba, but Trixie spin did a lot of damage there to Bulba, and Trixie's only in a half life. Four stuffed in close, and then just destroys the Rubik. who also had himself a dominating spree, and Bobble won't get out this one safely either. When I said it was nice to watch, doesn't seem like it's that nice for Liquid right now.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I'm not too sure what Liquid was doing there. They saw the Vanguard on Trixie, and they see that he has the cloak as well as the four staff. He's extremely tanky and not susceptible to any sort of damage at all. All Liquid had in that fight was pretty much Visage Nuke as well as Bulba's Roar to secure a bit of damage. And all they had was that initial burst damage coming out from the spells, and plus the Rubik's Fade Bolt, that did not contribute enough at all. So I'm not sure if they probably should have been aware that the Vanguard will shut down all the forms of right clicks at this point, blocking 80% for 40 damage. And I'm just surprised that they attempted that in the first place, because they didn't have Koipa or TC. And even if Koipa was there, looking at his items, I'm doubting that Koipa does enough damage. So going on pretty much the hardest target to go on right now on the side of Fnatic, and in front of their tier 2 tower, when you saw TP rotations coming in, not the wisest decision out of Liquid. And of course, TC still has everything that he had, but giving up slight advantages like that here and there, Fnatic are going to catch up very safely, but very sound and very fast.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's just I can't believe this lineup has worked as well as it has.
Which one?
Fnatic's.
I see the synergy, but once again, it's like at the top lane, I feel like an ample number of things could have gone better for them. But
definitely.
I do agree.
Definitely.
You know, I have been speaking to Liquid rather often, and basically, even though once again they're on like a 16-game winning streak or so, one of the things that they struggle often with, I feel like, is their complacency with their games. A lot of times, their players are very content with just farming up around the map, which is why you said something interesting about how much map movement they were giving to against Fnatic. Like, they were just walking around in enemy jungle and looking for kills nonstop. And sometimes it gets the better of them, like that scenario with the axe at the bottom just now. Mm-hmm. But if they get too complacent, on the other hand, what's going to happen is, in this game, Fnatic have two Midases and Fluff.
That was really, really nice movement. Orca came in from Major's Prophet as well. But Nota was moving himself around, doing the ward block onto the Ancient area, realizing obviously when you got a Gyre on the field, you need to stop that from happening. But he leapt himself in, and then that Blink Dagger coming out from the Rubick, combining it up with also the Leap from Morana. He moved in quick. He got he got the control with telekinesis, and then allowed Koifa to TP himself in, put off the Orchid, and then the damage was too easy to pick off the Mirana. Just nice, quick, jumping movement from Liquid.
Yeah, nice rotations coming out of Liquid. Let's just hope that they really can keep it up, because at this point, you give any more room to Fnatic, once again, they will capitalize and take it a mile. So right now, they're farming up their own jungle. Way Too Sexy, however, has the Aghanim Scepter, and we all know the power of the Visage with triple bats. Even against the Axe, if the bats are not in the proximity of the counter Helix, those bats will wreck, absolutely destroy supports, and even the Weaver, who is pretty squishy to right-click, so...
Yeah.
Fnatic will have to be relatively careful, but Liquid, now on the hunt with the Smoke Gank, which no longer is seen by anything on the map, unless the smoke is revealed, so... Let's see if they can catch out Hani, who is farming the jungle. He's getting pinged out.
Hawk let him see it. Fluff actually blinks himself into the tree line, which he'll break with the telekinesis drop down and the cooldown as well. That was commitment to make sure Infogo died straight away. Even Koifa's positioning. Oh, Trixie. Sentry wards are there. They can see Fluff and stuff quite clearly. He leads himself away and out of range of Fly's ultimate. And now the arrow comes in from the side, allows the Culling Blade to then go into effect. So it becomes a one-for-one trade, but you've just lost your Invoker for your Rubick. And you're bailing out very, very quickly. This will now be a push down the middle lane coming out from Liquid.
Yeah. Liquid did lose their Rubick, but they know, once again, that trade was in their favor times 100. So with TC with the Aegis still and picking up the Talisman of Evasion, which...
Weaver's bugs being used, and Prophet's ultimate bounces through and takes out the Mirana on the way through. Prophet now going to TP himself in here, decides to cancel it because he saw Hani coming up the ramp, but Trixie is still very, very low on life. But with Hani around there, he can't really commit to that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a wise idea. Of course, a cold snap is pretty much the bane of many, many Intero's existences, and Prophet does crumble to the right clicks of an Invoker with a cold snap. So, wise decision and good awareness out of him to see that and not commit to an axe kill, which would have been worth it if he got out scot-free, but probably doubtful that he would have done so. And nice Sunstrike coming out. But see all these how all these small intricacies just change up the game. Like, if Trixie got the Culling Blade off appropriately, he would have had the cooldown for the next Culling Blade on Fluff, and he would have also given 40 movement speed and attack speed to everybody on the team. If his first Culling Blade came to pass, the other targets might have survived because they would have been able to run out of range of the Rubick or chase him down faster. But unfortunately, the Calling Blade did
bottom
not
lane,
connect. And what is
TC,
going to connect is
there's your Sunstrike. The call down comes as well, but Invoker's already got the pick off. And Bulba, he's going to be very, very happy he's got himself this Invis rune on him. Or else he could have found himself dead as well, but I'm wondering if he's thinking about picking off Flying Llamas.
There are bats coming, and there is a Prophet.
Oh, there's a Sentry Ward, though. One leap away by the Mirana. They saw him over on the side, and they're going to roar to kill off the Courier.
Nicely done.
That's commitment.
Yeah, that's nicely done, though. I got to say, that's definitely worth it. Hindering item progression between 12 to 15 minutes. I'm not too sure if you could have best asked for a better timing than maybe for the first 3 minutes.
One thing he didn't stop, though, was that Hand of Midas arriving for the Weaver. If they picked if they picked it off before the Hand of Midas arrived, then we'd be able to say that was a lot bigger thing. Where right now, like, Trixie's nowhere near his Blink Dagger. You got a Hand of Midas up with the Invoker, so he's got 3k gold up on him, but knowing Harney, he's going to be rushing up something else. In fact, he just gets his BTs, but he'll have to go back to base to pick these suckers up.
You know what? Normally, I'm not a supporter of Hani's choice of items sometimes, but I gotta say, this BT is a very, very wise decision. Once again, we look at the mobility coming out of Liquid's heroes, and if the Evoker is there to be able to react appropriately, I mean, BTs just help them do that so much more effectively. And Midas BTs, two of the best items to help you transition into the late game, just in case anything happens. So, I'm in full support of that decision for the first time. I like Hani's build.
We'll make a note of it in our logs. Bulba on this bottom lane. This is such great positioning from him. I just want to give him props for what he just did then. A simple thing like having a ball rover on the left-hand side of the tree, because you don't have a ward there. In fact, there's an aggressive ward up from Fnatic that's watching the bottom lane. But the fact you got Bulba in the lane, farming up from around this area, and he's already got that huge area because of the axes, but can see the gang is coming, saw the two heroes on the side, still stay close enough to get that experience. And now backs up, smokes up with fluff and stuff. He's only got the ball that's caught inside of this, but there's a sentry ward over from the Radiant side, so they saw this coming. Which means this gank is not really going to work, but it's Liquid moving and trying to make the action happen. And they're going to come
now
in towards
the middle.
Now, this
is the amazing
lane.
Thing about Priestess, Toby, is that when you spot out a gank like that, you can also counter-initiate with
arrow
this.
From No-Tail! It connects on him as he's trying to TP out. But with the Starfall damage, the Battle Hunger, and then Axe just Culling Blades him down. So 36 seconds on the sideline for Bulba, after I was just praising him.
That's just the beauty of Mirana. Sometimes when you see a gank and you can escape it, you can also follow it up immediately with the Moonlight Shadow, which, once
way
again,
two.
Not players are aware of or prepared for all the time. And now taking a little bit of harassment damage from Way 2, but Way 2 is now the one that's getting pursued. Let's see if he gets caught.
Yes. Yeah, 1 second arrow only, though, but you got Frostbite, Nova, and Sunstrikes on the way in, so even if CM didn't have the follow-up there, it would have been enough for the Sunstrike. But Way 2 was playing a very weird and interesting game. He was baiting the Weaver to come into the side chop, so his Familiars, which had only just stomped down, could come up and do some damage to him. Because he knew he had vision because the sentry was, so he attempted. I think he actually really attempted enough harassment to push Era out of the lane.
I think he's just trying to create a little bit more momentum and space for his team. Of course, when the support hero is zoning out the enemy carry, by trial and error and by the rule of just canceling each other out, matching things, it's a very efficient trade, but unfortunately he got caught and cost him dearly, but he will be back. He did not lose his bat, so that's a slight positive if you want to look at it that way. Interesting item build coming out of Koipa. I am starting to see this more often ever since the Shadow Blade nerf, but is it worth it still on the Prophet? I don't know. I'm having a hard time trying to figure out what the most optimal build for Prophet is. In this kind of game, the burst heal is very important because, yeah, a lot of Fnatic's damage relies on just bursting down targets and following it up with the Culling Blade. So mech is definitely a necessity, but I'm not sure if Prophet's the best candidate to pick this item up. What do you feel from all the games that you've watched?
Well, I'd feel right now that Aegis Prophet becomes a lot more of a circumstantial item. Like, if you play him like you do, like the mid-solo into utility kind of style, like, that's one option you can have. And when you have a hero like a Visage also on the field, like, you want to be able to free up that extra farm. Prophet's already going to give you a split push. If you're looking for him to do off damage and just to, like, split push through Shadowblade and through elusiveness, then that's okay. But if you want to have him split push through strength and power, then I'm a massive fan of this build as well. Prophet, for me, is the ultimate utility hero. He can do anything and everything. So, this build's fine.
Yeah, it's not so much that I'm just questioning the build. It's just I feel like, what can you get out of the build, and what kind of things can you get more out of the build? Because when I see a mech on Prophet and I see heroes like Beastmaster,
no tells in trouble. On this team, pick him up, throw him down. They're gonna roar as well. The Weaver Bugs are coming in with the axes and the Fade Bolt. There's enough burst damage from Liquid to get this job done. Now the time lapse out from Era Fluff and stuff though. He's got Shikuchi, so he's able to hide himself in the corner. And he can see where Weaver's moving because their own sentry wards. But that gank was meant for the Weaver, not the Mirana.
Yeah. This is coming to that point where this is my problem with the specific item build, is that if you want to do the mech, I feel like you have to get a little bit more out of it by actually having scenarios to use it. One of those scenarios that you can force yourself to use it is when you have a hero like Beastmaster and Visage on your team, heroes like that, you can actually just go to the Roche Pit really fast and just take it out really, really quickly with a medallion or something like that on the team. And I do hope that Visage does pick it up eventually. But see, if they're trying to transition into the mid-game, late-game with those Aghanim Scepters on their heroes...
Might have to wait a moment, man. Hani's going to come up. Pulse snap. There goes your Meteorite. Koifa. A lot of damage. Meg Charge keep him alive a little bit longer. But that last attack coming in from the Invoker kills the killing spree of Team Liquid's Koifa. And the rest of Liquid will have to back up. They use the Mirana ulti to initiate in towards that one. But really, it didn't give him much of an advantage because the Sentry Ward was still down. But they did manage to catch out Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, that's once again, another fear with Prophet is that if I'm an Invoker player or a mid lane player, one of the heroes that I'm always looking to snipe out is the Prophet, because I know they don't rush BKBs. So, this mech, I really hope it pays for them very, very soon, because TC, with all those deaths to his name, he's not farming very, very well. And of course, he will have the BKB soon. But once again, we have Era, who picked up the Midas and is going to start making the money back and already getting extras out of it. Mm-hmm. And Honey, who's had that Midas forever, along with the Boots of Travel. I feel like if the game goes late, even with the Nature's Prophet on the opposition as well as the Gyrocopter, I am a little bit scared for Liquid just because of the sheer farm that Fnatic are getting on their important core heroes.
Uh-huh. I also noticed you've seen the bonus gold coming out from Trixie. He keeps coming in and cutting bleeding down these Visage's familiars. And then just follows up, and he does a lot of damage too. Just some basic attacks coming into those familiars.